Oh, nobody knew about when the Norris went except for a small group. Why did everybody across Europe, not everybody, but a significant number know about Columbus? Yes. Yeah, the prison runs. And that came. Languages, all. Oh, we just changed everything. We lost our great memories. So with that, and we got nation states. We got inventions. That's what we're good, right? We got the right to inventions. The Protestant Reformation. Talk about, did we get to market revolution, the new economy?
Yeah.
Didn't we get to the commercial revolution?
Yeah.
And the beginnings of capital. What's capital again? Yeah, the means of production, the machines. This is pre-capitalist. Pre-capitalist. And what? Yes. And another one I didn't put down there, but I should have, was printing press. Printing press was like after that, the first real capitalist endeavor, because it actually was a machine. You know, a machine that could produce much faster than people, much faster in writing. Yeah, that's actually like, you see that, that's capitalism. By the way, capitalism always has a tendency to get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, aka monopolies. It has that, it's endemic in the system. And then they kind of destroy itself. So there's got to be, there's controls. It's an interesting thing. We'll get to it because it has such a massive effect on our life. And arrival of Englishmen. So let's get the 16th century break. Because we talked about the Spanish. You read about the Portuguese. You know, the Portuguese going around Africa. The Spanish going. So the Spanish. Portuguese here. By the way. So Columbus went down to here and then went across because he knew the what of India. Yeah, the latitude. Those are lines. They couldn't do longitude accurately to about the 1780s. You need a clock. You need a very good clock. They didn't have an accurate one that was transportable until 1780. So, Spain, by the end of the 16th century, these were areas they all claimed. Every place in yellow was New Spain. Portugal. This has New France and Britain, but they didn't have claims yet. Britain and France had sent explorers, but Spain became huge. But the problem Spain has, they had all this money, all this wealth, and they quickly spent it all. Just spent it all. Ironically, destabilizing the Chinese economy and leading to revolution. So they had wealth, but they went on like a perpetual crusade. A crusade against Muslims, a crusade against people who are not Catholic, just perpetual crusade. And they would continue this all through the 17th century too. So Spain was so powerful, it's hard to even wrap our mind around. And by 1700, they were a decrepit empire. By 1800, they were kind of a joke. It's just amazing how fast it happened. This could be called a cautionary tale. So their other big issue was, to colonize an area, it's called settler colonization. Because of disease, they wanted to bring people who are relatively loyal to Spain, or as they saw as loyal. And they wanted people who are not native, with the idea being that they would be loyal to the colony. But they only took Catholics. And that greatly limited the people they could bring in. And so newer colonial powers, they could be more, you know, open. Because they just want people from outside to come in who would be relatively loyal. That's why Britain, who was, in fact, in 1588, they weren't even Britain yet, still. They would call the island Britain, but we have England, which had conquered Wales, so England and Wales, and then Scotland was a separate kingdom. They'd be unified under King James. He was the king of Scotland, he would become the king of both, and that's where you get Great Britain. In fact, Britain does have a red flag, so you see the Union Jack right there. That would be 1605, I'm sorry. And see the red diagonal cross in there? That would be put in 100 years. So before, it was just the blue field, white, and red cross. So, Britain, they're relatively poor. England, than Britain, but they're dynamic. They had just come out of a series of civil wars. They're going to have a horrific one in the 17th century. But they don't have enough money to start their own colonies. Colonies are really expensive. So they will come up with clever ways to do it. The first attempt was Roanoke Island. Sir Walter Raleigh, who was a favorite of the Queen, Queen Elizabeth, he was a soldier and a pirate called a privateer, meaning he captured Spanish ships for the crown. He started a colony right here. He wanted to establish a toehold, and part of the reason was because of the printing press and the amount of gold that Spain did bring back. I mean, the amount of gold and silver doubled in about 70 years, which totally destabilized the economy. But it doubled, and the thought was the whole place must be made of gold. As it turned out, no, it wasn't. And the Spanish kind of made that known, but then, of course, people in Britain were like, oh, they're lying, there must be even more gold. Terrible place for a colony. These little finger islands out here, every storm will hit it. They're small, they're isolated. It's just a terrible place. But that's where they kind of do the first colony. 1585-1587, just as they are going to war with Spain. And what was the famous attempt? We give the name of the attempt, it's kind of the war, the attempt by Spain to attack and invade England. What was that called? 1588. Yeah, the Armada. Yeah, the Armada. And yes, it was a massive Armada, but it was insane to do. They're taking those half of the fleet were the galleys with guys rowing and taking them on the Atlantic with their flat bottoms on the rough Atlantic and one storm, half gone. By the way, those poor men on the ship, I don't want to think about it. But, disaster. But they couldn't go back and check on the colony. So when they went back in 1590, there was nothing there. And that's where you get the name Lost Colony. And all they found on a tree was the word Croatoan. And to this day, I'm going to ask, we don't know what happened to them. They didn't know. Croatoan was a neighboring tribe, so they very well could have just joined that tribe. That happened all the time. All the time. They would join a neighboring tribe. The tribes were devastated by disease, so they were desperate to bring in people who didn't seem to be dying of the same disease, at least at the same rate. And it was a real problem for the English colonists. Colonists would get there and realize things aren't much better, and they go join a tribe. Especially when women would just leave. Because they're treated so much better with the tribes. By the way, there a whole myth came about how women would be mistreated in tribes to keep them from running away. And it was a really bad movie, usually starring John Wayne. Had it on a first day. Oh, where they found archaeological dig where they found where it was. If it's one, we're thinking of the same thing. There's a patch over this area right here where the Croatoans live. And I think of it was a peninsula, but that's very well where they could have lived. And?
So, who exactly went back to find the lost colony?
Raleigh. Oh, okay. And they're dying, they died of disease, they just said, let's throw a lot. Which makes sense, doesn't it? They could have all just died. That happened too. Another likely idea is that the Spanish just sailed up from St. Augustine. St. Augustine was a Spanish colony right here. Still a city, so it's the longest European settlement of what is now the United States. And they might have just sailed up and killed them. And this used to be a French Protestant colony called the Huguenots. And the Spanish just sailed up from Cuba and killed them, cut their throats and dropped them in the bay. So there's precedent. So I should add, the colonies here, and I come to the colony, one of the first things they did is build a fort because the Spanish not. They're just really fearful of that. But we still don't know 100%, but yeah, there are some more clues. My guess is starving, where did the Spanish join? And this is pretty swampy, so they move, get into the interior. Probably. But one of the great mysteries. So if that one didn't make, what survived? What's going to become the Chesapeake colonies? And I call them that. There's reason for that name along the Chesapeake Bay, but this is something they use in the AP exam a lot. They refer to these first colonies, it's Virginia, Maryland, it's Chesapeake. So I want to make sure we hear that name. Because it's one of those, boy, you know, you get a question, you're a little bit nervous, see Chesapeake, like, okay, now I remember, it's these colonies right here. And they start right here. So these would be the first and the richest colonies, at least at first. So right here. And this is a picture of meeting the Powhatans of Jamestown and also from the Powhatan War of 1621. So they kind of combine them into this weird painting from about 1640. And Jamestown, named after Elizabeth's successor, so Elizabeth did not have an heir because she was not married and she was the Virgin Queen. Thus, the Virginia Company of London, named after her. Now, almost certainly she was not, that was not true about her, but it kind of fit in with the aura, they kind of the reputation they wanted to give of her, like being above that, also because she was a woman. It was a way to establish a little bit of credibility for her. But this is the first, or this is an example of a company, they've been around, this had happened, called the Joint Stock Company. So this joint stock company, it was made up not of one person, but investors. Now, there really wasn't a lot of wealth in England at this time. Boy, things would change in about 100 years. And so they found investors to start this colony, but therefore the country, the crown, King James, could do it on the cheap. And shareholders owned it with the expectation of a profit. So, you know, if they have 10% of the company, they get 10% of the profit. And this is the precursor. What?
Is this sort of where a corporation?
Exactly. That's exactly what I was going to ask. This is what we call, you know, a precursor to corporations. Now, corporations are a legal entity with a bunch of laws. There's reason companies become corporations and now dominate every element of our life. But they won't be created until 1830, the modern corporation. And we all know what country the first corporation was. I mean, everyone knows. This is just such common knowledge. It's the most obvious country. Yes.
So is the Virginia and London Company of London a joint
stock? Yeah, it's a joint stock company. Where did the first corporation start? We all know. I mean, it's so obvious. Let me just say it. Belgium. You were all thinking it, right?
Yeah.
The brand new country of Belgium. Yeah. You're like, obviously. Where else would you start one other than Brussels? So, by the way, they're not kidding about the laws. It's a real thing. They can try them here, but you have no idea. Road trip? Run there, get some waffles, come back. We'd be at reach back up one period. Should have said it down hungry. So that. And so they got a contract. A contract, you ever heard of charter? All a charter means is a contract. So a certain legal binding agreement. That contracts are such a big deal, they are enshrined in the United States Constitution. That contracts will be protected. And they got a contract basically saying you must do this, this, and this, but you get this land. And so Britain can do it on the cheap. So Britain didn't have to put the money up themselves. They give it to the London Company and then collect taxes. And then eventually they would do what they did. They would come in and take it, make it a royal home. But they gave them a land claim. By the way, I love this picture. I love this. And do you catch? Read it carefully. But that's an S. That's how they made S's. About half the S's would look like an F. So it's not a misspelling of an obscene word, it's such. So you read it and it's like, what is the F there for? So, and then they have that, and see, it's about the same, isn't it? And sometimes they make S like an F. Let me get a hand up.
I'm sorry, what did you say? Oh,
go ahead. Yeah, they didn't, the crown didn't have a lot of money.
Okay.
So they could do it on the cheap.
Yeah.
And then eventually the crown would just take over.
So they would become what's called a royal colony down the road.
So like, was it separatists?
That we call pilgrims because we've all been, we all grew up in the United States.
They had, it was the Plymouth Company. The Puritans had the Massachusetts Bay Company. And then eventually the crown would take it over. And so with that, Chesapeake Bay, why there? Far away from the Spanish, protected. It seemed that some explorers, but also fishermen, would sometimes land here. And so it just seemed like this would be a better place.
Same deal with the separatists right here, they want to be away from there. We want to be near those Anglicans, which is the Church of England.
And Britain just gave, oh, and what they thought was the whole thing was a mountain of gold. So the thought was, we'll go there and start this colony. Sure, we might find crops or something, because the Spanish had already found a crop that they could grow in the New World that was literally like gold. What was the crop they found they could grow?
Yeah.
Tobacco. No, tobacco, not yet. The Spanish found this. But good guess. It's tobacco we could call them, yeah. Maize. Maize is valuable, but not like gold. Yeah.
Sugar.
Is that what you're gonna say, sugar?
I was going to say maize.
Yeah. Maize is valuable, but sugar was gold. Sugar was amazing. Boy, you should have seen the teeth of people in Europe about 100 years after the Spanish arrived. See? My little thing for the American Dental Association. So with that, this has mountains of gold. Mountains. So there's the arrival of the Englishmen. That makes me laugh. And they were given a land claim. So you see this area right here to here, this massive area? The crown just said, this is our land from these two latitude points. What gave them the claim? They just said it. And no, they didn't bother to ask the people who lived there. And where did this claim end? The Pacific. They gave them the claim all the way to the Pacific. North Carolina, all the way to the Pacific. By the way, the French also claimed this, and the Spanish claimed it, and the British didn't care. New Jersey had like this, see where New Jersey is now, and then all of this. That was their claim. Needless to say, when the United States was created, there was a few competing land claims. In fact, fight over the rich Ohio Valley would lead to a war that would eventually create the U.S. called the French and Indian War. I'll tell you a story in just a second. So you have all these land claims, so that's what they get. In Britain, we'll collect taxes and make money off. And they'll put up the brand new English flag. It'll be our colony, on the cheap. So the first colony arrived, I didn't put the date down, so put down 1607. 1607. And very quickly, this would be dubbed the Starving Pot. There'd be 144 colonists, almost all men, and almost all dandies. Dandies are the second sons or third sons of noblemen. The first son got all the inheritance and the title, or most of the inheritance. So what are the second, third, fourth sons if they survive? And this is a time where a third of all children died in childbirth. That's why life expectancies are so low. What were the second, third, and fourth sons get? Yeah? 1607. I should have typed that in. I thought it. I thought about it. Isn't that good enough? Isn't the thought? Yes. Son, like the second or third sons of noblemen. The eldest son got the land and the title, you know, the knight that served the nobleman, whatever their noble title was. Second or third sons? They might get a little land, but that's it. And so these are rich people who wanted to get their own big landholding. And this is going to be an issue throughout the colonies, too. So like the third son of this relatively prosperous planter in Virginia would lead an expedition to try to claim this area in 1754. His name is George Washington. It would start a war that would eventually lead to the American Revolution. Kind of weird. George Washington was everywhere for a while. am. What skills do they have? You think about a colony. Don't you need things like carpenters, people know farming, a cooper? What's a cooper do? Really important at a time when you need to store things. They need barrels. By the way, ever get a chance to watch a skilled artisan who's a cooper? It's amazing. I went to this place and was watching them. You guys were unreal. That's always one of those things that remind me how amazing some people's skills are. We all have interesting skills, and then we never quite figure out what they are. But it was really cool. But, you know, weavers, you need all these kind of skills. They didn't have them. They had the skill of trying to get rich so they could get a big country estate. That was their goal, to build a big country estate. By the way, if you ever go to the South and see those plantation manors and the way they look with the big columns, they're copying English country estates. See, we made it! They were hoping to go back. They couldn't go back, so they stayed. And they arrived. So they went up the James Estuary. And the thing about the James Estuary, that's where the river runs into the ocean. It's affected by tides. The water is brackish and salty. So they went sailing up, and they should have went a little further up. They're like, we're tired. We all have scurvy. By the way, three ships. And Susan Constant, Discovery, and the Goodspeed. No, you didn't need to know them. I just like saying, I always like the ship named Susan Constant. For some reason, I think that's a neat name. What were Columbus's ships? Do you know those?
Santa
Maria.
Nina.
I heard someone say it. Pinta? What ship did the separatists arrive on? Yeah, the Mayflower. They have a replica on it, it's tiny. You go there, right? There weren't that many of them doing this. If you're claustrophobic, be a fun laugh.
Where did they
sail? Huh?
You said that they sail up.
The James River. The James River right here. And the thing was, late summer 1607, by the way, there's not much time for winter ends. That's really swampy area. And as they sailed up, you have this kind of swamp and not really a good place for starting a colony. And then, because it's tidal estuary, high tide, low tide, there's a sandy beach that runs into the river. So think about a sunny day. Sandy beach. What did it look like? Gold. They're rich. They anchored the boats, got out, they dumped out all of their supply from the barrels to rot on the beach and started shoveling gold into the barrels. Very carefully labeled them, topped them, and sent them back. Their riches will be there to start their estate back in England. I always wonder what happened when the, you know, the tars were unloading the ship. And like, why did you send us sand? And what happened that winter? That's a hint. The next ship arrived and they just found only about a quarter left alive. And then the next ship arrived with double the number of settlers into that summer. Remember, they have to sail pretty much in the summer because of the weather. So they were out pretty late in the summer and they're just barely making it. And what did those first settlers arrive? What did they do in 1608? They dump all their supplies out and shovel sand and send it back. And they thought the settlers there were lying to them when they realized it was sand. So by 1610, they were all starving to death. It was a catastrophe. So this nice stylized picture of the stockade they built there. By the way, if you go there today, they have a remodeling of the fort. And it's amazing. It's really a cool place. It's also really hot in that part of Virginia. If you like heat and humidity. And right across from Jamestown, on the other side of the peninsula, on the York River, is a town called Yorktown, the last battle of the Revolutionary War. And then, in between that, the Confederates built trenches. There's a series of fights that they call the Siege of Yorktown in 1862. So this is all one big historical park. The trenches are all still there. And if you ever get a chance, it's really cool. And the old colonial capital, Williamsburg, there. It's
Has anyone ever been there? So a few people? Pretty cool, isn't it? It's wow. Williamsburg is right there, the old capital. It's one of those towns where everyone acts like it's still about 1700. It's one of those, if you get a chance, wow, is it cool. So, as they're starving in the summer, one of the first things they did, or what the Spanish did, they enslaved the local native population. But there weren't very many diseases. There weren't very many. Almost certainly smallpox and measles that just wiped them out. Now, Europeans are susceptible to these, just not as much. And by 1610, virtually all were starved. Here is a picture from a manuscript showing a woman fighting off people from her cabin. Because what are they going to do? They were hungry. Mm-hmm. In 1610, when the resupply ships arrived, and it was awful. There's just between 20 or only 38 left. And this is after the first 100, and then another couple hundred, and then another 100. So there have been almost 300 people come, only 38 left. There were people on the beach gnawing on human bones when they came in. They had dug up graves and were eating the bodies. And let me go on record as saying this. You can write this down. This is something you can take with you for the rest of your life. Cannibalism bad. Okay, if you're not worried. I mean, we can talk. But other than that, cannibalism bad. Right? I'm showing my bias there. Yes. Yeah. It was double. They all thought it was bad.
But they were doing it.
You're not desperate. When you're hungry. I mean, most people have never been really hungry, at least here. I don't mean like you miss lunch by an hour. I mean like really hungry, like 5 or 6 days without food, a week without food. I mean, I would spend a year without food. The mountain was dropped in, no food. There's nothing. I can't get all that out. But one time I was late for lunch and all. Yeah, they did that and they were punished, but they all know it, but they just. And there's something about cannibalism. People who become cannibals, I mean, they really, the guilt of it, they literally just, it's like a total break. When the Donner Party was going across California, they got lost and they got caught in a snowstorm. Up in Sierra Nevada, it snowed about 100 inches in a day, and they're stuck. Yeah, they said they just went out first. First question.
This may be a dumb question, but how come they didn't, you said this was in the summer.
Well, they arrived in the summer, but the starving time was in.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, why didn't you just go
and find food? And the problem is that swampier, there's not a lot of animals. There's not as much food. It wasn't easy to find.
Yeah, I guess so.
And by the way, let's be clear about it. I said cannibalism was bad, right? You good in that? So did I change anybody's lunch plan? Okay, good. Moving on. So 38 survived. What probably saved them more than anything else was the Powhatans. The tribe has lived in the interior. Now, they have been devastated by disease, too. But they have been fighting all their enemies. So the Powhatans begin to trade. But the big thing is the English would help them with their enemies. Here is a meeting of the English, all with their armor and guns, always have their guns, meeting the Powhatans. And this tribe. And as long as the English stayed around Jamestown, the Powhatans were like, okay, we can use the English. We can use the English to fight our enemies. Of course, they weren't thinking that this happens all the time. Sure, the Powhatans tried to use the English, but the English were using them. And that's probably how they made it. Most famously, also in 1610, John Smith also arrived. And we don't know exactly what he did because he lied so much about his accomplishments, but he helped organize the colony. Hey, we got a farm, you might have there, these. And made alliances with the Powhatans. So Smith had some, didn't even run out of the colony because he was kind of a scoundrel. I know you know this whole story because of the very accurate cartoon Pocahontas that Disney did. And I asked first period, they all watched it.
And that cartoon's pretty old, but who had seen Pocahontas? Yeah, that's the true exact story of what happened. But it's 1612, yeah.
Yeah, he was going to Jamestown. And he
also,
he got contracted by the separatists and cheated them. He's kind of a scoundrel.
But John Rolfe was one of these dandies, and he began to plant a crop that they had found there called tobacco. Now, the Powhatans had grown it, other tribes had grown it there, but with most of them died, their farms, they had some cleared land and land that they were farming on, but it's growing kind of just on its own. And when you lose that many people, your farm, you can't really farm. Which, by the way, perfect for the for Jamestown, it just came right into that land. And so, John Rolfe, he cleared a small path and realized you could grow pretty quick. And by 1627, hundreds of thousands of bushels, and this would save the London tribe. So this now would get to tobacco. And this addictive drug would become the, which is take Europe by storm. It became the thing to do to either smoke tobacco or sniff it. Grind it up into a fine powder and snort. Yeah, eat away your nose. And it gives you, give you this really powerful high. There's, have you ever seen a movie from like the 18th century or something like that? They show them like snorting something. It's tobacco. It also would eat away the septum and you get a horrible headache. So it's not a good time. Yes?
Yeah, they thought that, like, they didn't think tobacco was a thing. They just thought it was a drug.
Well, they didn't even think that term was a drug, you know, so. This is right. Yes. And, yeah, they just didn't realize. For a while. Yes. They didn't know the effect. I mean, the total extent of alcohol due to your body, but they knew alcohol would make people do bad things. It was a real issue. England went through a gin craze. And it became a big thing. We got to get people quit drinking gin. It just became like unbelievable in the 17th century. In fact, that's part of the reason why they emphasized tea, trying to get people to quit drinking gin. And tea really took off there. And tea has caffeine, which is another drug, but. So. And that's where you get this political marriage between John Rolfe and Pocahontas, who was Matokia, but for some reason, the British, they mispronounced everything, they got Pocahontas out of that. And there was a political marriage between her and John Rolfe. She was 16 years old, got married. She went to England. I was in this little church in London, and I took a picture of this, St. George's Church, and did that little thing on Pocahontas, because she went there when she went to England. She died of disease while she was there. I mean, this was a political marriage, you know, we're cementing our relationship. And yes, she was very young. Those political marriages, you get a lot of relatively old men and very young. Most people didn't, it wasn't like that. At this time, they would get married in, you know, late 20s. A little later on, you get really young. But that's where the whole story poked on. So let me get to a couple of things in really quick. So, plantations begin to pick up. English term just means big farm. Clear the ground. They cleared as quickly as possible. You have to do slash and burn, or they just kill the trees and plant around them. Trees are unfortunately very easily to kill. Easily to kill or easy to kill. I like trees. Yeah, there's another one. I'm thinking of a kind of controversial stand. I'm opposed to capitalism, and I like trees. That's a capitalism?
Yeah, I just
capitalism. We're going to talk about capitalism, too. By the way, did you see right out there was a kettle of vultures? Is that computer? You know what? Is that saying about that? Am I still here?
I really don't know.
I wanted to make sure you understand that. No, I tried to look for it. This is one problem. I teach 3 AP US history classes. Sometimes I forget what I tell people. By the way, the bad part about that is you might hear the same thing over again. You're like, yeah, whatever. The bad part is if I think I told you something you need to know and I didn't tell you. That's the bad part. So I'm warning you in advance. I do that on purpose just to punish you. Okay. So, back to the vultures. No. So, these big landholdings, and they just, to kill a tree, you just take a knife
or they called it a plug, and just rip all a ring around the tree about an inch deep, just gouge it out so the sap doesn't go to the top and the tree just dies there. And then they plant around it. And let it fall. But they want to plant so fast they didn't want to waste time slashing and burning. The problem is with tobacco cultivation, you know, it has noticeable leaching of the soil in 3 years. It sucks the nutrients out. If the American Indians would plant the tobacco with maize and beans and squash, and the soil would be replenished with nitrogen, here it just sucks it. So the yield drop dramatically, and pretty soon you have land that's kind of worthless for a while. So they constantly need more land, so they're always pushing west. So you can imagine what's going to happen. As they push west, they're going to run into whom? Those full houses. And that's going to lead to war. So they're allies with the political marriage. By the way, here's them beating the Powhatans. That's John Smith and Pocahontas. Here's going up the James C. plantations, moving up in just a few years. How fast they moved. So the Powhatans, devastated by disease, begin to fight back. They formed a short-term alliance with their enemies, other tribes. These never lasted. If they could have formed a permanent alliance with the various American Indian tribes, we might have a different history, but they just kept fighting each other because, well, that's what Europe was doing too. You know, these groups all fight each other. And they did a surprise attack in 1621 on virtually every single settlement where the English were in this area right there. And they killed as many as perhaps 40%. Here's a very stylized picture of the slaughter. You know, this English one, you're like, he killing her. Made it very dramatic, but it was brutal. These types of wars are brutal. You know, the thought was, we'll terrorize them and get them to leave. But it almost worked. The Powhatans won. They won. Britain was going to pull back the Jamestown, agreed not to do anything else. And so they agreed to have a feast. Copy through a mask, close your eyes up. You can watch me drink water. Isn't that cool? And I know I'm old, but I drink water much like you do. The feast, the Powhatans were already developing a taste for wine that they were trading for various goods, so they brought out some wine. All right, here's some wine. What happened? That's actually kind of what the U.S. would do, but the English did. Poison. The English poisoned the Powhatan though. And women made the big decisions on these eastern tribes. Women were basically in charge, but since men, they're kind of in their division of labor, men did the fighting and the hunting, it was the men there. So the best fighters were all there. So who won? The English won, victory! And this would become the template. War after war would be fought in this manner. Sometimes it'd be outright destruction, but if there was a chance that the English might get beaten, they had a peace conference. And you would think they would learn, but remember, they didn't know. And so, this is where these Chesapeake colonies, eventually Virginia and Maryland, they would prosper financially, but the companies are going to be in big debt. And so the big thing about that was, if the companies are going to be in debt, eventually that's why the crown would take them over. Individuals made money. The company lost money. Does that make sense? I'll talk more about corporations, but that's why they are so profitable. They're so profitable that people in here actually paid money to advertise for corporations. That shows you how what a big deal they are today. That is me. First period, it's like every person in class has some corporate shirt. I have no idea what that is. I'm sure.
Onyx.
What is it?
This.
Huh?
That's you run in by like if you're on public land, private land.
Oh, I know what that is, yeah. Give me a second. Yeah, that made it here.
bunch of corporate students. That's where they all were.
Maybe.
Oh, we got Shields, and yeah, okay, there we got a corporation. Polaroid, well, that's old. Oh, you like that? Edith is a massive corporation. You're fine. No, it's just the society we live in. So the problem is they had land then for these plantation owners. But as you can see, the land was beautiful. But they didn't have labor. They needed workers. And most people, this might shock you, don't want to go to a strange land and work for virtually nothing. Our concept of wages are different than their concept. But still, to be worked and probably die for virtually nothing in a strange land. I know some of you might want to do that, but most people didn't. So they needed to find a way to get people to work. I already mentioned one when they were enslaved laborers. I didn't quite get to fornication law. Can you forgive me? I will do it Tuesday. Can you forgive me? I see some of your eyes like, just hold on to it. I am sorry. Let me do one more thing real quick. Oh, we're jumping there. We're not going there. So they're labor and they wanted Europeans. They wanted Europeans so they could say, this is our land, especially British. So then they would be loyal to the crown. And this is what they would do. This is a replica of a sign for indentured servants, but it's written in such a way we can read it. Free land, free ship, indentured servants. Desperate British, and here are ads for them. And by the way, you catch the, here's an ass. I got a few asses here, but like we have Glasgow in Virginia, and then young man understands the F's. Desperate. They've been kicked off their land because they're now have their sheep pasture. And these desperate peasants, you have to be just in misery. You think about it for a second, how bad your life must be to be willing to go to a strange land where you know you might die in the first 6 months. To be 7 years as a slave, but then after 7 years, you get freedom and a head right. A head right is 50 acres and maybe a little something else like seed or something, but you get that little piece of land. And that was it, you get that little piece of land. And all you have to do is sign a contract, a charter. And that's why indentured servants were such a big deal. Here's the contract, you sign it, you have this piece of paper. Who had those contracts? Citizens of Britain. I'm an Englishman, I get this contract. Who didn't have the contract? The American Indians were enslaved, and who else was coming in? People of African descent. They were basically indentured servants too, but they didn't have the contract. By the way, the first 6 months of this, you had a name for it. And the name is actually, it scares me. It kind of almost says shivers down my spine. Season. Malaria ravaged. Malaria came over from Europe and just ravaged people. And they had no idea where malaria came from. It just was there. And there's two kinds of malaria, and it hit the Englishmen bad. Africans only affected by one strain. I wonder what that's going to be. What do we have on Tuesday? Quiz. You want a reading assignment? Chapter 3. And to the bottom of that, of the those notes, you're not going to turn them, but those terms that you identify, those will be the answers to the quiz. And anything you write down on that sheet, you can use on the quiz. I want everyone to get 100. Reading assignment. Are you ready?
Thank you.
See you tomorrow. I'm at Tuesday. Can you see my book?
We can.
It's called laser disc. In the early 80s, people were like CDs, and they tried to show that, it was like a half hour video. I think it changed a lot. Because you have to read page 147 to 1000. It's actually a pretty short read. Just 147 to 156. Okay? Does that make sense? So you'll know when you get to the war. It's a really big chapter, so I have to chunk it up.
And all I have to do is read it.
So assignments for next week. On Tuesday, do the short ID or the chapter 3 quiz?
We're going to do the short ID on Wednesday.
On Wednesday.
I decided to move it a day, and I'm going to tell you the terms on Tuesday. We're going to do a quiz, just a simple reading quiz on Tuesday.
And then the notes are due Tuesday?
I'm not going to call. I'm just going to quiz.
Okay.
So if you anything you want to put down, you can just use on the quiz, but I'm not calling.
Cool.
That's what I'm giving you. Sound good?
Sounds good.
Thank you. Everybody grab one of these. I come bearing gifts. I know. I give and I give and I give. Have you heard that I give? I give.